turboprop. Embraer started its history with the development and production of a turboprop, the EMB-110 Bandeirantes, which built the case to found the company. After the Bandeirantes, Embraer had three other turboprops on its history, by which only two went into production, having great acceptance by the market. All four models totaled 963 units produced, by which 498 was from the Bandeirantes within civil, cargo and military variants, aimed to be low cost and serve remote and regional areas with precarious infrastructure. It was an aircraft propelled by two Pratt & Whitney PT-6A and had the capacity to carry until 21 passengers and two pilots, a maximum takeoff weight of 5,670 kilos, and a range about 1,025 nautical miles, cruising at 260 knots. The second model was the EMB-121 Xingu, an aircraft designed with executive and military variants, which used the same wing design and engines from the Bandeirantes. The model had the capacity to carry up to 9 passengers and 2 pilots. It had the same maximum takeoff weight from the Bandeirantes, with maximum cruise speed of 242 knots at a range of 1,268 nautical miles. 106 units were produced. The last turboprop by Embraer was the EMB-120 Brasilia. This aircraft was designed for regional flights with the capacity to carry up to 30 passengers. The aircraft used the same design concept from Xingu's fuselage, wings, pressurization, and more powerful PT-6 engines. In 1994, the model was the most operated aircraft for regional flights all around the globe, and had a high safety record, receiving a special safety award from the FAA. At this time, the Brasilia was the fastest, most economic, and the lightest regional aircraft for 30 passengers. It had the maximum takeoff weight of 1,980 kilos and a maximum cruising speed of 315 knots and a range around 1,400 nautical miles. In the future, its design helped Embraer to develop the ERJ aircraft. Besides, the Brasilia served as a badge to the development of an advanced prototype with aftermounted engines on pusher configuration, the CBA-123 Vector, which gave to Embraer some experience in such kind of engine configuration. Due to changes in the company strategies after going private and due to financial difficulties, the project of the CBA-123 Vector and the turboprop production were discontinued, and all the resources were directed towards the development and production of the ERJ aircrafts. Today the market is showing a demand for aircraft with 50 seats for regional aviation, which would connect smaller regions to larger communities with a range until 1,000 nautical miles and vice versa, as well as connecting those smaller regions between themselves. Such markets demand smaller and fuel-efficient aircraft, but today is only possible to find mainly two models, which designs are outdated and they are not much fuel-efficient by today's requirements, not to mention that they inspire a sense of unsafety and discomfort in the passengers. They are the ATR-42, its bigger variant, the 72, and the de Havilland Dash 8-400. Disregarding both aircrafts, the only option available would be narrow-body jets, which have more seats than necessary, consume much more fuel than a turboprop, and sometimes have limitations to operate at certain airports. Despite the Havilland had stopped its production, arguing that a continuation will happen at the site of new demands in post-pandemic years, ATR have a backlog of over 190 aircrafts, proving that the demand already exists. Embraer see a market size of around 1,008 new turboprops worldwide, led by Asia-Pacific and China. However, the company say that demand in North America might be bigger than the expectations. So, with this picture, Embraer decided to revive its turboprop segments, developing a new project, and the business case is expected to be concluded by the end of this year and approved by the first quarter of 2023. But what will this new airplane look like? As the business case for this new aircraft is still under development, some of the information here might change during the course. So it's important to highlight that all we know is based on primary information released by the company. The new aircraft would share the fuselage with the E-jets, with two variants. So, at this point, we see a synergy with the existing production line in San José dos Campos and suppliers. The variants would be one with 70 seats and other with 150 seats. For a while they are named TP70 and probably TP150, the TP70 would be a fit for US customers, which would choose a configuration with 50 seats separated in two classes, although the TP70 could be configured in three classes with 50 seats. The TP150 would focus on low-cost company for short hauls with bigger capacity, but the company have not decided about which variant will be the first to debut. This decision depends on market factors. The new airplane will have aftermarket engines, and this is a very strategic design decision, because such configuration would future-proof the aircraft for a possible hydrogen version. This is exactly what you've heard. Embraer plans to launch a hydrogen version of its new turboprop. And since hydrogen is better contained on cylindrical tanks, it couldn't be stored at the wings, but in the rear section of the fuselage. Hence the advantage of having the engines aftermounted. But we will talk more about it later. An immediate advantage of having engines in such configuration is that you have much more comfort inside the cabin, as all the noise and vibrations generated by the engines and by the propellers will stay behind the passengers. The three major engine manufacturers, GE, Pratt & Whitney and Rolls-Royce, have offered their engines for this project. They are all bidding new technologies, and Rolls-Royce would have offered its first turboprop engine project. All suppliers bid engines considering the burn of 100% sustainable aviation fuel, and the hydrogen model would have been considered as well. But this type is only to the next decade, as we will see later. The TP70 and TP150 are expected to have a range about 800 nautical miles, and the cruising speed has not been formed yet. Embraer is now defining suppliers and performing tests with its concepts. Investments in the development continues throughout this year, and the company, as previously mentioned, is expecting to have its business case finalized by the end of this year and get the approval by the first quarter of the next year. Then it will go to secure investments to fund the production. If all goes well and as planned, the new aircraft will enter service between 2027 and 2028, ahead of the ATR Evo.